Well, I'm Arjan van Essen. I'm working at two universities and a software company in the Netherlands. Regarding the infrastructures, I worked for the Dutch Clarin part and partly for the European Clarin part. When Clarin in the Netherlands stopped in 2015, we got again a grant, and now I'm working in the board of the Claria, which is in the Netherlands a combination of Clarin and Daria. And moreover, I'm working in a software company where I'm involved in transferring the knowledge from the academic environment into, well, the business environment, so to say, and all related to language and speech technology. My task is user involvement, so I'm close to the outreach and the impact. The outreach, in my eyes, is the degree in which other people are aware of the infrastructure. So if you say, well, I'm working for Claria, and they look to you, say, well, what is it? Can you eat it? No. I mean, the outreach is zero. So outreach, in my perspective, is that you know about it. The impact is something related, but the impact, in my eyes, is that it makes a difference if you use that infrastructure or you don't use the infrastructure. So if you have a high impact, it means that a lot of scientific programs, research topics, all kinds of initiatives in this field are using the technology and the infrastructure developed in this case, in Clarin and Claria. Yeah. I believe you have the highest impact if the users, so the researchers who are using the infrastructure, tell other researchers about it and say, well, guys, you need this kind of infrastructure because it serves a lot, it serves to you, it helps you a lot, and without this infrastructure you can't do the things that we, using the infrastructure, can do. So it's a mouth-to-mouth, well, how do you say it, advertorial, so to say, that other researchers, I mean, that's the strongest case, if other researchers tell the other researchers that they use it and why it's so perfect. I mean, it's the same with the text processor. In the past, people didn't work with the text processor, and then Word came and Word Perfect, and people told all the other researchers, well, it saves a lot of time, because if you make an error, you don't have to type the whole page again, but you only correct the one word and that's it. So that was helping a lot for the impact. First, the outreach. We are visiting, I mean, in the Netherlands, we are visiting all the universities at the moment, and then it's morning or an afternoon, and we ask, let's say, between 30 and 50 humanities scholars. We show the history of Clarin, where it came from, the current state. We show different software packages for language and speech technology, for linguistics, for structured data, media studies, everything that's available at the moment, and we show some use cases, and then we dive into the software, well, more deeply, so to say, and show them how they can work with that kind of software. And as an example from my own field, speech recognition, we have an audio file, and I say, well, it's a long audio file. I can upload it, submit it, drink some coffee, and then I get the results. And yeah, of course, there were errors, but it saves me hours and hours of work. Instead of transcribing it, I just wait some time and I get the transcription. And that may open the eyes of some researchers that they say, well, wow, it is working. No, it's not perfect. It will never be perfect. So don't replace the humans by the infrastructure, but make infrastructure that helps the researchers to do the things better and easier and faster. And what we try to do in this kind of meetings that we organize with different universities is just showing this this result of the infrastructure. And then in the end, most are convinced. However, and that is something we have to do, they see all the technology. And what we see, you have the technology, you have the humanities scholars, and that's not always an easy bound, so to say. Because most humanities scholars are, well, I'm not, you can't say they are afraid of computers, but it's not in their DNA, so to say, to program, to make scripts and things like that. So sometimes they are a little bit hesitant or are afraid of, say, okay, that's very nice, but me, how can I use it? So what we are making or doing now with the board from Claria is making showcases, very easy showcases. So I'm a researcher in this media studies. I have a video. I can upload it. I can do this really step by step, showing them how easy it is and how they can profit from the availability of this infrastructure. And that's sometimes difficult because also the software is difficult to understand. So you have to explain difficult software to people who are not used to use this kind of software. And it takes some time. And the best thing to do, we have figured out, is organizing workshops. That you have a nice workshop, you will bring your own data. What is your problem? We do have software. And then spend the whole day on trying this software and showing them from, hey, okay, it's not that easy, but it works. And we did that recently in Arezzo, in the field of speech recognition for oral historians, where we did have the software. We did have the oral historians with their own data, English, Italian and Dutch, and say, well, bring your own data and we will show you how you can profit from this technology. And it was a huge success. But so it's a big effort. I mean, that's only oral history and you have a lot of people. But we believe that's the best thing to do. But it's not only sending, it's also receiving. So what we did in the workshop in Arezzo, for example, we brought together the technicians from three countries developing speech recognition software for oral history, and the researchers in the field of oral history. And the first technicians were explaining what the software is about, what's possible, what's not possible. So that was sending from technology to humanities, the humanities scholars. And then we asked the humanities scholars, hey guys, what do you need? Because otherwise it's only technology push, and that isn't going to work. So we were really asking, suppose you have some interviews, what do you want from, and what do you ask from us that we are developing? That doesn't mean that it's possible for us to develop everything that you want, but at least tell us. So in this meetings between humanities scholars and computer science, so to say, it's very important that everyone is listening to the other one. And initially we had that error and we say, well, you need this, and that isn't going to work. You really, it just has to be a dialogue, so to say. We have a website, we have newsletters, but that's only for our own community. Well, it turns out it's only for our own community. It doesn't make sense if you tell some humanities scholar, hey, there's a website about Claria, and they are reading it, and, well, it's not, I mean, their cup of tea. So you really have to convince them and ask them, hey guy, what are you doing? Give me your research topic. Hey, you know that if your research topic is this clustering of information, we do have software that can help you. And don't make the error to tell them that you can replace their work with software. It isn't true, but also if you start with this kind of, well, you can do a lot more and it can be done automatically, then they're a little bit afraid, so I will be replaced by your software. No, that isn't the case. The software is supporting software. It helps you to do your work better, faster. You can read 100,000 documents with a computer, and as a human being, only 500, so to say. And that's the language that you need to use to convince them to at least try to use this software. So initially you have to really ask the scholars, what's your problem? Can we help you? Once it is a success, you may hope that they influence each other. Say, well, go to Claria and ask them for the software. But it's a lot of work. We always ask scholars if they do, they have a publication, they notice, tell at the end with thanks, with the help of Clarin or Claria, or I was using this software, blah, blah, blah. But that's the more classic approach, the number of publications. We are looking, and that's more difficult to measure, but we are looking for the impact. How many people are using our software? Are there other infrastructures, projects, proposals that are referring to Claria? And that's what's happening now. I mean, other people are proposing for infrastructure projects as well. And then they always refer to us like Clarin, Claria, and it will be an addition on the existing structure infrastructure from Clarin, and that's helping a lot. So we do have an impact, we know that, but it is difficult to measure. And at last, we hope to reach a situation that the Claria infrastructure will be used in the education at the universities. And that's also difficult to reach, but that's what we're trying to do. Set up workshops with master students, PhD students. I mean, they are more flexible and more willing to use modern technology, but to show them, hey guy, we do have this software, what do you think, and can you use it? And we had a couple of very successful workshops, but I mean, there are a lot of students in the humanities in the Netherlands, so it's a lot to do. But that's something that what we're trying to do. So the best, our dream will come true if a lot of infrastructure projects are created based on our basic infrastructure, if a lot of researchers are using the infrastructure, referring to business speech recognition from Clarin, I did it, blah, 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 and a lot of master students, and also in the curriculum at the university, the Clarin infrastructure is used for teaching. The use of the infrastructure will be the absolutely most important item of the success of such an infrastructure. The awareness that computer science can help you, that there is software that can help the scholars in the research. It will help the scholars also in the to preserve their data, in the sustainability of the data. And that's very difficult at the same moment. Give the researchers the opportunity to use already standardized, sustainable, stored data for the research. And we see that in the social science, where a lot of scholars see, or no, teachers see, making your own corpus is part of your curriculum, and that may be important, but it means that a lot of students are collecting their own data, but there is already so much data. So the reuse of existing data, in our eyes, is absolutely important as well. So if that's happening, if we have a lot of data and a lot of other scholars are using existing data, that's also part of the success of Clarin and Claria. The difficulty is that you have to convince people to come out of their comfort zone. I recently tried something at my own university, that means Utrecht University. I studied mathematics and physics and also Italian. And I tried to convince the Italian professors that there's a lot of technology out there that you could do wonderful things for your research. Students are helped if they finish their study, in this case Italian, if they are capable of using modern technology, if they're capable of using computers, this kind of software. I mean, there's only once in the 5-6 years you need a really Italian researcher. So for most students are going out in the industry, in public publishing houses and things like that. So you do help them if you give them some knowledge how to use, what is available, and how to use that kind of software. And the students like that. I mean, most students, we had a workshop 2 years ago, Making Sense of Digital Spaghetti, and it was for the University College in Utrecht and also for the students from the humanities studies here. And the students said, well, we need that. If we want to work out of the university, they always ask us, can you use computers, what's, etc. And normally the answer is, well, nothing. Yeah, I can use Facebook, Word, Google and things like that, but that's not enough. So helping them with this nice technology and will create bigger and better opportunities for them to have a nice job after their studies. One of the things as a researcher that I hope to reach, I mean, as a researcher, I'm involved in speech recognition and the things around that, going from human speech to written text. For that, we are collecting a lot of data to build the speech recognition engine, to do all kinds of context modeling. For example, if you talk about, we do have a project now for the Dutch Parliament, where we want to recognize everything said in Parliament. Well, the language used in Parliament is quite specific. I mean, it's normal Dutch, but they use other words than someone telling about a party last night. So that means to have an optimal result, we need a parliamentary language model. that covers the way politicians speak in our national parliament. So we are making this model, and we do it for our project. But I hope that the research infrastructure can help me to publish and to make this language model sustainable. We are going to the next project, and that may be something completely different, but I hope that I can store the language model and the data the language model is based on in a repository, and it will be there for the coming 5 to 10 years, that other researchers can profit from the stuff that we did. And that's basically what we needed as researchers. Sometimes, I mean, now we do have good connections with the Dutch Parliament, so that means that we can call them and say, well, we need your data, and they give the data because they trust us and they like the project. But for other researchers, sometimes it isn't possible. So what we hope to reach, that you do have an infrastructure where you really can shop, and you can say, well, I want data for this language model, or I want data for this, well, OCR project, or things like that. And that the data is there, that you can use it for non-commercial purposes, but for your research purposes, you can access and you know automatically, oh, I see how I need to process this data. So the benefit for researchers, as far as I see it, is this getting data from others and storing your own data so others can use it. Of course, it will be important because we spend a lot of time and also money for this parliamentary data collection. So the only thing that I'm asking, of course, we can't ask money to them, say, well, we want it to be paid for at least 20% of the effort. No, that's impossible. But at least if they do, they use it, and that they mention our work, our university. So with the help of the collection of the University of Twente HMI group, this is possible. I mean, that's for me, for us, our biggest dream. And that's said that. That is one of the biggest problems that we see in the research infrastructure as researchers. Why doing it? I will help others. So I spent a lot of time clearing the data, making the data available to others. And in the end, I mean, it isn't a publication. So I'm not personally granted for all the work that I did for clearing and storing the data. And that's something, and that's more also a management stuff, but that's something you need to change for the researchers. Grant them, help them to get something back from for all the effort that they put on collecting, cleaning, and publishing this data. If you have a lot of data and make the data available to other researchers, you're helping them a lot. But the university isn't granting that, so in the end they say, well, the amount of publication is below media, so sorry, we have to leave you. And that is very difficult. You need to pay the researcher, and of course not with money, but with the honor, with the mentioning. I mean, you have a nice article, and that's also what we ask in Clarion, but that's the management part. But we asked, if you have a publication, please mention Clarion Claria for the software and the data. And that's the same for the researcher. I mean, we always do it. If we use data from other, at the end we say, well, thanks with, and then naming the group or the researcher for delivering their data, cleaning the data, and without their data we couldn't do it, and things like that. I mean, this beneficial or mutual mentioning the others, thanks for your data, and I'm giving my data back to the public, to the is very important. But in the end, it is from research to research. I mean, that is important. And then there's some intermediate, and that's the research infrastructure, who helps in delivering and telling about the data available. Say, well, do you want the data? I will deliver it to you. Because maybe in 5 years' time, I'm doing something completely different. And I mean, that's what we see sometimes. A lot of data, 80%, someone was mentioning, of the data from the humanities scholars is at home, in their CD, in their I don't know where they store it. And then they stop working, or what else, do something else, and then the data is lost. And I've put a lot of effort the last years to convince old scholars who who are going in pension to say, well, give me the data and we can see what, and say, but it is not 100% perfect. No, I know no data is 100% perfect, but at least we can publish it and make it available for the future generation. If you don't do that, it is lost. And that's a pity. The whole structure in the scientific world, it is the publication that counts. It is the book and the article, the presentation that counts, and not the data behind it. But the data are important and more important. So someone needs to use his force to convince or to force the scholars to do it.